Hello and welcome. I'm Alexandra Wybell from the International Federation of Accountants, and I'm joined here today with two of the chairs of the international standard-setting bodies. I have Dr. Stavros Thomadakis, chair of the International Ethics Standards Board for Accountants, and Professor Arnold Schilder, chair of the International Auditing and Assurance Standards Board, or IAASB. And we're here today to talk about audit quality, which is the focus of the IAASB's recently released invitation to comment, referred to as the ITC. It focuses on three main areas, but the one that we'll focus mainly on today is professional skepticism, as relates to your respective bodies of standards, the ethics code, and the international standards on auditing. We'll also discuss some of the other key areas on your current work plans and agendas. As we all know, auditors play a key role in the credibility of financial statements, which in turn builds public confidence and trust in those financial statements, as well as the global financial infrastructure more broadly. So I'll start first with a question for both of you. High quality auditing and ethics standards for professional accountants go hand in hand toward protecting the public interest. While your boards are separate and independent, there are times when issues come up that impact both of your areas of work and when close collaboration between your two boards becomes necessary. So what are the current topics of mutual relevance to your boards, and how is work being coordinated and aligned?
Maybe people are not aware that much, but we since long have a close coordination between our boards and at times also actually with the education board. We did so, for example, on the audit reporting project already, where there is also an ethical dimension. We had it when we developed a framework for audit quality, also active participation. And behind the scenes, our senior staff is ongoingly in dialogue. And it's even evidenced by the fact that the technical director and deputy director of the ethics board are coming from the IAASB. So people know each other quite well, and they are very much aware that they should liaise on seeing where there are overlapping areas. So I mentioned these two examples. Now, as you alluded to in your introduction, the topic of professional skepticism is a very important one. It's very important to many. So we have established a joint working group, which is led by Annette Keuler from our board, but it has equal participation from the Ethics Standards Board and the Education Standards Board. And there we discuss the common issues in this very important topic.
Well, I must say that I'm very conscious of the need to coordinate between the two boards, although they're independent. And we have been actively seeking that, not only at staff level, but at the leadership level, being in quite close contact between the two of us. And I should bring as another example the issue of the standard that we call NOCLAR, the reporting of non-compliance when the auditor or the accountant encounters such an instance. And this is an area, of course, where there has been very active and quite detailed, I would say, cooperation on coordination, rather, I should say, between our proposed standard and the standards of the IAASB. So this is a very active and very current living example of how we work together.
Stavros, I'm glad that you brought up the subject of non-compliance with laws and regulations, or NOCLAR, as we call it. This is a very complex and difficult project, particularly as it touches on client confidentiality and whether and when that fundamental principle should be set aside during appropriate times, of course. So how does client confidentiality relate to audit quality? And can you give us an update on where the board stands on this important topic?
Thank you for the good question, Alexandra, and thank you for recognizing upfront that this is a very complicated standard and a very complicated issue, because it really is. The standard has been worked on for 5 years now, more than 5 years, and I'm really hoping that the whole board is planning to finish this quite soon, so we hope to finish it within 2016, after such a long time. Now, what is this? This is, of course, related, as you correctly said, to confidentiality. And confidentiality is one of the fundamental principles upon which the code is founded. And confidentiality is a very valuable fundamental principle because it enables a free flow of information between the auditor and the management of the company being audited. However, in some instances, and this is what our standard is about, it is necessary in the public interest that confidentiality can be bypassed. And these are instances where the auditor comes up with serious cases or suspicion of non-compliance that may have serious consequences for the company and for its stakeholders. And then he must be in a position to exercise a right to disclose if he thinks that this is in the public interest and if he determines that there is great damage, grave harm that can be caused by the non-compliance. Now, the hope there is that before the auditor does a disclosure, if he decides to do this, he alerts management and tries to have the non-compliance corrected or its effects mitigated. So there's a whole process that does not exist in the code so far. And the question is, will this affect audit quality? And I say, no, it won't, because in the cases where there is compliance, actually, confidence and the flow of information will be enhanced. In the cases where there is no compliance or non-compliance issues, the free flow of information may not exist anyway. Because if you have non-compliance, you have reasons to withhold information. So on the whole, I think that this will, on one hand, serve the public interest, and on the other hand, advance and enhance audit quality and the effective confidential relationship between management.
Thank you, Stavros. Arnold, your board also has a project addressing non-compliance with laws and regulations. Do you have anything to add?
As soon as the ethics board had drafted its exposure, we established a working group to see what the consequences should be for the ISAs to make it corresponding. We published those proposed changes to the ISAs pretty soon after the ethics board. We got feedback, of course, and we will discuss that next week in our board meeting. The task force is proposing indeed a number of amendments to the ISAs to bring them fully in line with the NOCLAR proposals from the ethics board. And then I think you are finishing that hopefully in May, and we will conclude on it in November. So it's really very close, stepping one after each other. We do, of course, share that this is a very important topic in light of transparency. We appreciate that concerns have been expressed. I think they have been dealt with carefully, both by the ethics board and by ourselves. And we're therefore confident that this will be a very good step forward in the public interest.
Arnold, this next question is for you. As we've been talking about, the IAASB is currently consulting on audit quality, and I just wanted to see if you could speak to the importance of this particular consultation, and also, what is it that you hope to achieve as a result of this extensive consultation, as well as the global roundtables, such as the one being held tomorrow here in Paris?
Well, thanks, Alexandra. Let me take just a step back to give the broad picture from the IAASB. We first have clarified the auditing standards, and they're now in practice. We then informed, after a couple of years' experience, were there issues that we needed to further address. And we got a positive feedback from experience with the clarified ISAs, but also, of course, a list of areas for further work. We put that on hold a bit. We first finalized the new auditor reporting standards, which brings the audit much more to the public domain. It's not just anymore one sentence from the auditor at the end, but a full report that is relevant for investors and other stakeholders. And now we have this consultation, picking up from what we learned from this ISA implementation monitoring exercise and the many feedback that they've got from a variety of stakeholders. They said, well, what are a number of key topics that you need to be further working on to enhance audit quality? And it came in the beginning as individual topics. Professional skepticism was often mentioned, quality control was often mentioned, financial institutions and fair values. And also the topic of group audits was added to that discussion. And then we realized when we started discussing that these are not separate topics, but they are very much interconnected. Just one example, applying skepticism is equally important to when you're auditing fair value estimates, if it's subjectivity and judgment, or when you exercise quality controls and organize that, you have to also be skeptical, are people behaving as it should, or when you are carrying out your group audits. So that's why we combined it in one, what we call invitation to comment in ITC. And again, in the context of bringing the audit out to the public, we are now engaging in many consultations. And as you said, tomorrow here in Paris is a very important one. It brings to the table a variety of stakeholders, and they will comment on these three topics, professional skepticism, quality control, and group audits, from a, let's say, holistic perspective. And maybe I can come back later on the fair value estimates and financial institutions, but that has been part of the discussion as well. But that's what we are doing.
You just mentioned fair estimates, which is the subject of our next question. I know that is one of your top priority projects right now that has been fast-tracked. And in light of perceptions by some that auditors need to do more to challenge management as financial reporting becomes more subjective, how do you see this project supporting audit quality?
When I was trained as a junior auditor, for example, there would be in a general ledger evidence of machinery that had been purchased. And you would look for corroborating evidence. Is there an invoice that confirms that this machinery indeed has been bought? It's a bit of black and white, but that's how it worked. Nowadays, as you rightly said, there is a lot of subjectivity and judgments in coming to the numbers in the financial statements. And what we call fair value estimates are a very good example of that. And goodwill, just as one example. So valuating, measuring the value of goodwill, so basically what it will be worth in the future, depends on a lot of assumptions. Management is making those assumptions and reflecting them in their choices for a final valuation. But then the auditor comes in. And you cannot simply say, well, show me an invoice or whatever for this goodwill. You have to challenge what management has done. So you have to inform yourselves about assumptions that are possible, external factors. You may consult with experts and specialists. And then you have to come up with an independent dialogue with the auditee company. And that's different from how auditing was done in the past. And this is in particular visible, therefore, in financial institutions where you have loan loss allowances and now a new approach, what they call expected credit losses, which is much more forward-looking as well. What losses may we expect on loans and other valuations based on these many assumptions? So that's the heart of the matter. And it's so important to many that while we started originally as part of the other topics that I just mentioned, we got a lot of encouragement first from our consultative advisory group. They said, well, don't focus only on financial institutions, but take it broader. It's relevant to many other companies as well, extractive companies like oil companies or pharmaceuticals, as somebody said today. Second, it's so important that you may want to speed this up. Amongst others, because this expected credit loss is coming in a couple of years' time. So we decided to go indeed even faster than the consultation on the ITC that we are engaging in. And we already have agreed on a project proposal. So the task force is working on that. And just a few days ago, we published what we modestly call a project update, but actually it's a very interesting document that summarizes the many issues that are here. And I can only say that the feedback so far is very positive that we are addressing this key topic. And there I should certainly mention that we have a lot of dialogue and outreach with many important stakeholders. On one hand, the financial regulators, of course, like the Basel Committee and insurance supervisors, but also with expert practitioners. And now we're reaching out, and certainly in many ways, to investors and audit committee members, share your views with us on these important topics. And that's how we want to progress with standard setting.
And now I'd like to turn the conversation back to Stavros, the Ethics Board and the Ethics Code. One of your priority projects this year, and one of the priority projects that's been on the agenda for a number of years now, is the project addressing the structure of the code as a whole. So can you tell me why this project is so important?
Yes, thank you, Alexandra. I am hearing my friend and colleague, the chairman of the IAASB, describing this impressive track record of what the IAASB has done, which has certainly already improved audit quality and will continue to do so. And it started considerably with the Clarity project. Mm. Now, the structure project that we have is an equivalent project, which has been taught a lot from the Clarity project of the IAASB, and which seeks to clarify the code in terms of giving it a better structure, in terms of rewriting it in a simpler and more clear language, and in terms of separating requirements from application material and guidance. It is the tasks that were successfully done a few years back by the IAASB. And for us, it is very important because it now is a time for doing this because of several reasons. First of all, clarifying the code will make it much more easy to use, much more easy to translate, and eventually much more easy to enforce. And I must say that this clarification project, this restructuring project, has been undertaken, among others, under the advice of regulators who wanted a code that could be more easily enforced. And mind you that this is a code that in its new structure will be much more easy to implement around the world, not just in advanced jurisdictions, not just in a few countries of the West, but in emerging economies and globally. So it is a very important project because it's pervasive, it affects every other project. And I think it's also a very important project for one more reason, if I may, that the ethics code is based on five fundamental principles, which I believe are well known. We mentioned confidentiality, but there are others: integrity, objectivity, competence, professional behavior, and so forth. Now, these five principles in a clear code will have a more pronounced and enhanced presence, and it will be more easy to have them related to the everyday actions of the auditor. This, I believe, will make a major contribution to audit quality. And one more thing, though. The restructuring of the code that we're doing now is imposing on us a new duty of coordination internally within the Ethics Board, because all other projects will have to, at the end, become restructured according to this new format. So that's one thing. The other thing, of course, is that restructuring will clarify some concepts such as responsibility, management responsibility, concepts which we need to also look in very close coordination with the IAASB. So I expect that restructuring itself will be generally an area which will give rise to a number of topics on which we should coordinate. So it's a very important project for all these reasons.
Thank you, Stavros. It sounds like collaboration as well as coordination are some of the key themes for both of your boards this year.
Right.
Okay, so now before we wrap up, I have one last question for both of you. As it relates to your respective areas of standard setting, could you tell me what are your ultimate aims? What is it that you aspire to? Arnold, would you like to start?
Well, it reminds me, I think, half a year ago, I was on a seminar in Singapore. And we were in a plenary session with a large audience. And in the course of that discussion, one of the IASB members from Korea, actually, said to the audience, well, in the end, these are not our standards, but they are your standards. Meaning that, of course, our boards produce these standards, but they only make sense if the public at large sees them, well, this is helping us in our justified interests. So that's the ultimate goal, I would say, that the standards are perceived and received in that way. But then, of course, it's important that they take on board also recent developments. And let me just, as one example, mention that we are currently also working on the topic of data analytics, which will have a huge impact on auditing in the future, and other forms of new reporting. So we keep an ongoing dialogue and hope to address what is of emerging new areas. And that's really fascinating.
My turn, thank you. I will right away agree with my friend and colleague that it is very important for these standards to become living standards. In other words, to become living things as they are used by auditors and as they are embraced by the public confidence. Because that is very important to have social value attached to these standards. And of course, speaking of ethics, this is paramount. After the crisis especially, ethics has become center stage in a lot of discussions, a lot of debates, and therefore the work we do for an ethics code for accountants and auditors must respond to a lot of new expectations and to a lot of public demands, if you will, for ethical behavior. We believe that prospectively, the ethical behavior and the ethics code will not only inspire more confidence for the audit profession in the public interest, but also will become a good factor, a strong factor, for the profession attracting young people. Because young people really want to see things clearly, things ethically, and things with a value content. And I believe that this is ultimately what we can contribute to from our side. One more thing I also want to say is that if our standards manage to become living standards, as you suggested, and if they become more and more, they acquire a life of their own in use, they will inspire more and more other professions which work together with accountants and auditors to also espouse ethical standards. I believe that that's very important too. So that's my answer, and thank you.
Thank you, Stavros. Thank you, Arnold. It's been a pleasure speaking with you both today, and I wish you all the best as you continue to develop your standards.
Thank you very much, Alexander.
Thank you, Alexander. It has been our pleasure too.
Sure.
Thank you.